What is the actual ecological impact of growing non-indigenous species? Is it actually good for the planet to be growing mangoes, avocados, bananas, dates in Italy, where they do not naturally occur? Many of my ecological conservationist friends argue that it is damaging indigenous ecosystems to do this. That's a contentious question. I encourage you to read the book by Fred Pearce. He's a famous author. He also wrote the book When the Rivers Run Dry, which was a page-turner for me. But the book that I want you to read is The New Wild, Invasive Species, The Saviours of Earth. So I believe it is good. And I think weeds are good and invasive species are good. They indicate to us there is a problem with the native ecology, but they also demonstrate to us that there's nothing wrong with novel ecosystems. Novel ecosystems are the future, and they always have been, and it was always going to happen. We can't have a purist view or a judgmental view about this has to stay in a historic botanical museum, because that's not natural. That's never happened. Right? The continents drifted apart and moved species. But today, you get driftwood rafts arriving with species naturally as well. Is that natural or not natural? Is wood supposed to float down rivers, end up in the ocean, rafted together, with seeds on or with animals on? Is that a natural event, or should we ban the floating of wood? I mean, where do you stop with this? Yeah, there has been some catastrophes on islands because islands speciate specifically to the limited number of diversity species on an island. So if you have not many predators, you end up with flightless birds because a lot of birds don't have to fly. There's no predators. And then a predator arrives and decimates that population. But all kinds of things trip and balance that as well. So on islands, you do get what seems to be quite dramatic losses and extinctions at times, but you get very few, if any, extinctions on continents because there's enough diversity across a continent to balance it all up. So, there's a lot of talk about rats and cats, but actually there's a lot of studies done that when you take out the cats from an island that are managing the rats take over and kill more native birds. So cats are often better when you have rats. Now it becomes a balancing act. What we have to be curious about is speciation. So, and all the great books that you can read, and I have a whole set of reference books that we put out here for you, my type of reading, what I'm interested in. I'm really interested in this subject because it started off with Charles Darwin and the Origin of Species, and he created the subject biogeography, the life of the geography. And Bill Mollison majored in biogeography. So immediately, whatever my teacher Bill was interested in, I got interested in. I thought it was of value. And I've read The Origin of Species probably many times, but there's things in that The Origin of Species and also in Wallace's work, who was competing with Darwin for this, speciation evolutionary study of life on Earth. Darwin talks about why did red clover germinate better around the English villages than it did out in the open forest? Why was red clover more abundant around the farming fields? And he studied, right, let's find a connection. What actually germinates, pollinates red clover? And it was bumblebees. And he thought, well, let me study bumblebees. Where do they live? And they live in holes in the ground. I said, well, that's interesting. Do bumblebees actually dig a hole? No, they don't. They live in vacant holes of other animals, particularly field mice. And so it would appear there's more bumblebees around farms pollinating the red clover and favouring the farmers because it's a nitrogen-fixing support species, if you like, know, it's high nitrogen, high protein fodder, and it also helps other crops with fertilizing the ground. But why would there be more vacant holes of field mice? And then he realized it was cats. It was the village cats which were managing the field mice population, who were quite prolific because they were eating our crops and our seeds, but they were actually allowing the vacancy of their holes to be occupied by bumblebees, which was increasing the pollination of clover. So there's a section by Charles Darwin, who was actually looking at connectivity between very diverse elements to end up with more fertility for human production. How interesting that he was going down that track of between a domestic cat and red clover. You can't see a straight connection, but there's number of elements between. Here comes one of our rainy season storms. So you have to have an open mind. You can't be assuming that you know better just because you have a sentimentality. Nature doesn't make assumptions, and nature doesn't have any sentimentality. It just looks at how a system becomes more abundant with greater fertility, particularly in the soil. And we're going to cover this quite a lot. So it goes way beyond you should only eat the crops that are grown in Italy or grown in one country or that's their endemic origin. Because where do you ask the endemic question? Where do you start? When are you talking about? At what point in history are we talking? Before the continent separated? After the continent separated? There's many things like this. Carrots come from Afghanistan. They were originally white. And they were speciated, in other words, selection, usually done by women, selecting better and better production, to purple carrots. But then, why are all our carrots orange? Well, mostly. Purple ones are now trendy again. It was a Dutch gardener who speciated the first orange carrot to favour the colour orange, which is the colour of the royal family of Holland, the Netherlands. It was just done to impress a royal family. And all our orange carrots come from that one gardener's speciated orange carrot. So it's an interesting question, but can we increase speciation? One of Darwin's finches in recent years was proven to have speciated. He studied finches on the Galapagos Islands. Multiple different finches, little birds, had speciated into different types on the Galapagos Island. One of them speciated into a new type of finch within 18 months, within 2 years. Unbelievable. It rocked the scientific world how quick things can possibly speciate. Can we increase that? Can we have new speciations all the time? In permaculture, we favor speciation to increase adaptive diversity. Now, instead of an extinction every 6 minutes, which we have at the moment roughly, could we have a speciation every 6 minutes by our intended action in our favor? Instead of losing an acre of forest every minute, can we gain an acre of forest? Yes, we can. Everything we do at the present time in the negative, we could do equally well in the positive. All we need to do is go into the right ethical design, science, action.